Well, good morning, everybody. Man, it's great to see all of you. Welcome to a brand new season, a brand new series. As Pastor Kalai said, blessed. And the tagline for our series is living in God's favor. And you know, the Bible teaches us that God is a father. And any parent in this house understands that you don't like to discipline your kids. Isn't that true? Like, I don't get up like excited, oh, I can't wait to like discipline them today. Or you know, when they do something wrong, oh yes, another opportunity for discipline. You know, no, I don't think that. As a father, as a parent, I want to bless my kids, right? I want my kids to experience my favor, not my blessing. I want them to, my favor, not my discipline. I want them to experience my blessing and not my correction. Isn't that true? And you know, the Bible says that God is a father and he wants to bless his children. He wants us to walk in his favor, not his correction and his discipline. And so the good news is that God gives us in his word instructions, guidelines on how we can walk in his favor and not in his discipline. You know, I just came back after Easter. I preached Sunday night and I had to get on a plane to go to Nashville, Tennessee, which feels like discipline, by the way. 13 hours on a plane. I don't know. When I was younger, it was fun. Now it sucks. Can I just be honest? I hate it. Anyway, my body's still a little sore from it. But I got back on Friday and my wife told me about how our son was acting out a little bit while I was gone. Oh man, you know, and I was so excited because now I get to discipline him. No, I was bummed, honestly. I was like, man, and so I grabbed my son Micah. I said, son, you know, I heard this is, you know, you're punchy, you weren't listening, you were kind of mean, you were talking back. Listen, I don't want to have to discipline you. Daddy wants to bless you and not discipline you. So here's how you can help me. Don't do those things that mom said and you'll be living in our favor. I didn't use those words. It just fits really nicely in a sermon, right? This is how you can live in our favor and not in our discipline. And listen, God is like that. He wants us to learn how to live in his favor, to experience his blessing as a loving parent and not experience his discipline. And so that's what this series is going to be about. So I want to encourage you, don't miss any part of it. All right, Acts chapter 2 is what we're going to look at this morning. Right after Jesus resurrected, ascended into heaven, there's this powerful moment that really was the start of the church. The Holy Spirit was poured out on the disciples as they were together at Pentecost. And we pick up the story here in Acts chapter 2. A huge crowd was there and witnessed the disciples' encounter with God. Peter gets up and begins to preach to the crowd, and this is what he says. And he's kind of giving them an outline of what it is to walk with God and to walk in his favor. Many of you may be new to church. Maybe you've just been joining us for the last few weeks. This is directly related to you, but also to those of us that are older Christians. Because sometimes we don't realize that as we've continued to journey on as Christ followers, we pick up some bad habits. We pick up some bad things that could be bringing God's discipline as a loving parent rather than his favor. Acts chapter 2, verse 38, this is where Peter is now addressing this crowd. Peter said to them, in response to the gospel, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children and all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And with many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. For those who received this word and were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls to the church. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to the prayers. And awe came on every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. Few things that we see in this passage, first of all, is that we're called to be a devoted Christ follower, not just a casual attender. We're called to be devoted Christ followers, not just casual attenders. What did Peter tell the crowd? He said, repent and be baptized. These are not casual terms. We'll talk about repentance in just a moment. But what he's calling them to is to a devoted walk with God, not just casual, I'll come when I want to come. I'll visit with you, God, when I have the time. What he's calling us to is a devotion. And the first thing, if we want to experience God's favor as a loving father, as a loving God, rather than his discipline, is we're called to be devoted Christ followers, not just casual attenders. Can I hear an amen to that? There's a lot of people that only come to church on Christmas and Easter, right? And I know that's not you because this is neither and you're here. So thank you. All right, welcome back. But that's not being devoted. Right, if I only went home to my family twice a year on special occasions, I would not be a devoted father or husband. Isn't that true? And we have to remember that what God calls us to is not a religion. He calls us to a relationship. with himself and with other Christ followers. And if in order to grow in relationship, it can't be casual. It can't be once in a while. It's got to be a regular thing that we do because we're growing in a relationship with God. Now, let's talk about repentance for just a moment. What repentance literally means, the word that's used in the original language is the word metanoia, which literally means to have a change of mind or a change of the way that we think. See, when we say the word repent, sometimes we just hear sorry, right? Oh, I'm sorry, right? I remember I was driving through Pearlside one day and a car was reversing out of his driveway and he hit my rear bumper. And so I stopped because now I'm like, oh man, I need to check the damage, right? And when this big local guy gets out and he goes, hey, sorry, ah? And I went, we're good. And I got back in my car and I just drove away. I didn't even want to see what was wrong because I was a small Asian guy, big guy. We're not going there, right? Now, how many of you would say that his, eh, sorry, yeah, was repentance? No, that's not repentance. That was get out of my face, loser, because otherwise I will pound you, right? That's what that meant. There was no repentance in his sorry. Real repentance would be, Naomi and I, when we were in college, we were driving through Pearlside. Again, what happens in Pearlside, man? I don't know. We need to learn how to drive a little bit better. But this car came, and we're at a stoplight, rear-ended us, boom, real hard. She flew into the dashboard, and she's totally fine after that. But the guy gets out of the car, and he's like, oh my gosh, I am so sorry. He gives us his phone number, he gives us his insurance. He's like, oh my God, is there anything I can do? We exchanged information. And anyway, long story short, he just sent us like a check, sent me, not her, because we weren't married, my money, sent me a check in the mail for a couple $1,000s to pay for the damage. That if you need anything else, if there's anything else that needs to happen, you let me know and I will take care of it, right? And so how many of you say that's a little bit more repentance? It's a change of mind. I'm not just saying sorry to God, sorry I messed up, I'm gonna keep on going my own way. It's like, I screwed up and I'm making a 180 degree turn and I'm not gonna go in the total opposite direction. I was living for myself. I was doing things my way. I was seeking my own pleasure, my own outcomes, my own goals. And then I realized something and I turned around and now I'm headed towards God. Now it's not about me. It's how can I serve you? How can I do right by you, God? It's a 180 degree turn. That's not a casual relationship. It's a 180 degree. I'm going for God now. And when Peter looks at the crowd after Pentecost, after Jesus had just been crucified not many weeks before, what do? We need to turn. We need to repent. We need to stop going the way that we were going and start heading towards God in the direction that he is calling us to go. Can I hear an amen to that? See, the word repent often gets a bad rap in our culture, right? Because God calls us to turn away from other things and to turn to him. It's total surrender. I'm not going to live for myself anymore, God. I'm going to live for you. Right now, that can be kind of scary, can't it? Especially when we don't know what we're really turning to, right? It's like, what am I really turning to? I'm turning away from all these things that I know, all this stuff that I'm comfortable with, living for myself. That's how I did it all these years. And now you're telling me to turn to and surrender to a God that I don't know. It's scary. But you know what? That's what we do when we get married. Isn't that true? Some of you just got real nervous right there when I said, that's what we do when we get married. Think about what marriage is. I could be heading towards all other 4 billion women on the planet, which of course not all of them would want you, but whatever. I could be heading towards all other 4 billion other, you know, people of the opposite sex, and I repent, I'm turning away from all of them, and I'm turning to you and you alone. That sounds romantic, doesn't it? Doesn't that sound great, right? But it's scary because I'm giving up so much. But unless you give up all of that, you can never fully have the blessing that is your spouse, right? Now, if we don't know what we're turning to and how great that is, then some of us are like this, I'm turning away from all of this to, what am I really turning to? And some of us are like that with God. We understand we need to turn away from a life of sin, living for ourselves, and we turn like, what am I really turning to here? But that's why when we understand that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, when we understand that he loved us while we were dead in our sins, and he came to save us even when we didn't deserve it, we understand that this God loved us when we were at our worst. And he calls us, and he desires us even when we did nothing for him. Then when we turn away from everything else and we turn to him, I know that what I'm turning to is good. I know that what I'm turning to is better than what I was turning away from. That's what repentance is. I'm turning away from a life apart from God, and I'm turning to a life with God. And it's only then that we get to experience the blessing and the favor that is of walking in a relationship with God. If we tried to get married and we said, well, I'll turn to you, but do I really need to let go of all of that? Do I really need to let go of all my ex-girlfriends or ex-boyfriends? Do I really need to let go of that past life? What would you say on the other side? Kick to the curb, loser. You know, I don't want any of that. No, if you're not going to really turn to me, then we can't really have a relationship. And that's how it is with God. If we're not going to really turn to him and turn away from everything else, why would we expect, or why should we expect, to experience the fullness of his blessing and favor in our lives? If I still had a side girlfriends on the side, which I don't, by the way, honey, I love you, I shouldn't expect to receive the full favor of my wife, right? You all would agree with that. If I was cheating on the side and doing things on the side and not telling her about it, why should I expect the full favor from my wife? I should expect her wrath, and I would deserve it, right? Why should we expect the full favor and blessing of God while we have side things going on? While we haven't fully turned away from a life apart from him? Why should we think that this holy God in heaven owes us anything while we're holding on to a life of sin back here? And that's why the very first thing Peter says is turn. Turn away from that old life you were living and turn to God. If you repent, you begin to experience God's favor in your life. Can I hear an amen to that? See, there are a lot of people who casually follow Jesus. We just casually follow him. And if we're just casually following him, we can't expect a blessed life. We can't. Because God is a loving father, and he's going to discipline his kids when we get out of line, because he loves us. But that discipline isn't to punish us. It's to bring us into a right relationship because he wants to bless us. That's how I feel about my kids. If I discipline you, it's because I want you to have the life that God has created for you. It's not to harm you or to hurt you. But if we're experiencing his discipline rather than his blessing, maybe it's because we haven't fully repented. Now, Jesus says it like this, and it's a little bit more severe. Watch this, Matthew chapter 7. He says this, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven." What's he saying? Not everyone who has a casual relationship with me will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, meaning when we stand before God or the judgment day, many will say to me, "Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name?" Jesus, notice he doesn't say, "No, you didn't. You only think you did. You didn't do any of that." No, what does he say? He basically affirms what they're saying. And he says, "Yeah, but then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness." But Lord, we did all these things in your name. I even called you Lord, right? Lord, I said it twice, Lord, Lord. And I did all these things. And what do you mean, depart from me, you evildoers, you workers of lawlessness? The key thing here is we see is when he said, "I never knew you." The word to know in the original language was the word ginosko, which meant the intimate relationship that a husband and a wife would have together. You knew about me, you knew of me, you did things for me from a distance, but we never had a relationship. See, what saves us is not the things that we do for God, it's the relationship that we have with God. What grants us entrance into heaven is not how good we were, it's what did we do with Jesus? Did we have a relationship with Jesus? Because he's the one who died on the cross and rose from the dead, right? And so what matters at the end of the day is not what we do for God, it's do we know God? Which is why we have a new class that we're launching for all of our new believers. If you're here and you're a new believer, you need to go to our Know God class. I just taught it at 9:15, and I want to invite you to come back. There'll be another one in 2 weeks, so you can go outside and sign up for that. But the whole point of it is to help us to come to the point where we know God. See, we can do a ton of other things, cast out demons, right? Prophesy, do miracles in God's name, but if we don't know him, at the end of the day, all of that activity amounts for nothing. Isn't that true? What is Jesus saying here? You need to repent from living apart from me and come to fully know me. You need to turn away from all that other stuff and come to me. And here's the thing about God. He's not standing there like this. Oh yeah? You think you want to come to me? You think you deserve a relationship with me? He's not doing that. Here's what he's doing. Come. Come. All that is required for a relationship with me is that you come. All that's required is that you turn and you come to me in faith. That's all that's required. I know you still struggle with sin. I know you still struggle with depression and mindsets. I know you feel guilty from your past. I know you're dealing with all of that stuff. I don't care. Just come. Makes no sense why we would say, "No, I don't want that. No, let me do it myself. Let me deal with my own stuff first. Let me get right before I even come to you." That's not how it works. Jesus says, just come. Just turn and come. And if you're here this morning and that's you, and if you don't know where you would go if you were to die today, if you don't know that heaven is your destination. I've got a word from God from you. Repent and believe in Jesus, because he wants to receive you. He's standing there with open arms to receive us. Peter says, repent, repent. And Jesus says, come to know me. See, we can know a lot about God. Like, I know a lot about Kobe Bryant. Know a lot about him. I was even wearing his shoes. Went to the game when they played at the Stan Sheriff Center against the Jazz last year. And I yelled out, Kobe! How many of you know he stopped mid-game and went, yo, what's up, Bill? Good to see you. No, he just ignored me. Because I may know a lot about him, but I don't have a personal relationship. But I'm wearing your shoes, Kobe. Come on, man. It doesn't matter how much we know about Jesus. We need to have a relationship with Jesus. You can read the Bible 100 times over, but until you come to a place of knowing him and walking with him, do you really have a relationship with Jesus? I would love to know Kobe Bryant, but anyway, it's not in... We can come to know Jesus a lot easier than Kobe Bryant. Anyway, whatever you think about the Lakers, that's totally irrelevant at this point, okay? Okay, and here's the thing. When we come to know someone and come into a real relationship with someone, we want to obey them. We want to walk with them. As I said, when I came home from my trip, my wife was telling me about stuff that was going on with the kids, and I felt bad being gone for 5 days, and so I tried to do the dishes a little bit more. I tried to clean up the house a little bit more, you know? But watch this. It wasn't to earn her love, and she's probably thinking, you could have done a little bit more. All right, fine. And it wasn't to earn her love. It was because I love her. And I know that you've been laboring, you've been struggling while I was gone, while I was working, but whatever. And I'm home now, and I want to serve you because I love you. See, we get it backwards. We think, I got to do all these things so that you'll love me. Christians, it's the other way. I know that you love me, and I want to do these things because I love you. It's not to earn your love. It's because we're already married. We're already together. We're already one in relationship. Now, because of that love, I want to serve you and love you back. See, we get this backwards. See, true love with God or true relationship with God will result in works. Works don't necessarily result in a relationship with God, but a relationship with God will result in good works out of love. Amen? So the first thing Peter said is repent. Turn to me, and then be baptized. And what baptism is an outward declaration, a public confession of what's happened internally. We're telling the world, we're telling our friends and our family that we're committed to Christ. And that's what Peter tells them to do. Repent internally and externally in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And if you're here this morning and you haven't yet turned away from a life apart from God and turned to a relationship with God, can I appeal to you this morning? That's the first step. You want to be walking in God's favor and experience his blessing here on earth. More importantly, his blessing eternally in heaven. It starts with repentance, turning away from a life apart from God and turning to God. And remembering and knowing confidently, he's standing there with his arms wide open. The second thing that we see that the disciples do in this passage was, it says that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. So we need to devote ourselves, be devoted to God's word. Now, the first Christians, they met together every single day. It says every day they met together and got teaching from the apostles. And, you know, we only meet once a week here at church, and we only ask for that. One of the reasons why they met every day was because not everybody had their own Bible. There was no printing press yet. In fact, the only scriptures were in the temples. No one owned a Bible. And so they had to meet together so that they can get the word of God taught to them so that they could devote themselves to it. You see that? But nowadays, we all can get access to Bibles, right? If it's not a paper Bible, any electronic device can get a Bible, right? If you're connected to the internet, you can download the Bible. And I just discovered our Pearlside app has a Bible in it. Did you know that? Why didn't anyone tell me? And so I was playing with it earlier. I was like, well, this is amazing. So anyway, we have no excuse about why we can't be devoted to God's word. And it's being devoted to God's word that helps us to have that change of mind. Right? Because all of us, we come in with all kinds of thinking, mindsets, things that have happened to us, things that have been done to us, and we see God in a weird light. We see life in a weird light. But as we devote ourselves to God's word, he begins to change the way that we think, change the way that we see God and one another, right? I mean, he tells us to we think, get vengeance on your enemies, right? Exert justice on people who wrong you. What does the Bible say? Love your enemies. Forgive them. Show them mercy. It even goes so far as to say, as to bless your enemies. Now, I still struggle with that one because I want to blast, not bless my enemies, right? But you see, we need to have a change of mind. And we wonder why maybe I'm not experiencing the blessed life or God's favor, because the way that we think and therefore the way that we act goes in direct contradiction to His word. God is not going to bless us if we're living a life in contradiction to God's word. But here's what He does do. He gives us His word so that we can change the way that we think, so that He can bless us and show us His favor. And you're going to hear a testimony as we get ready to wrap up in just a little bit. Hebrews 4:12 says this, "For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and joints and marrow. He is the discerner, a discerner of thoughts and intents of the heart." God's word is meant to cut into the way that we think, what we believe. When we read the Bible, it should cut us to our core, right? We're thinking a certain way, and it's supposed to cut us. It's almost like there needs to be a disclaimer on the Bible, you know, warning, I will cut you, you know, because it's supposed to do that. And if we're reading the Bible and it's not cutting us, it's not challenging the way that we think, then maybe we're not reading it, or maybe we're not reading it right. And maybe one of the reasons we don't want to read it is because we know it's going to cut us. Well, that's a good thing, right? Surgery to take out that cancer, it's going to hurt, but it needs to happen, amen? If we don't go through the pain, we can't experience the blessing, right? We know giving birth hurts, or so I've seen, not experienced, right? But if you don't go through the pain, you're not going to experience the blessing of new life on the other end. And God's word says it's going to cut, it's going to hurt, but it's because there's new life that I want to bring on the other side of it. The Bible is our essential spiritual food. We need to read it and eat it regularly. People say, well, how long should I read the Bible? As long as you can. How long should I read a day? As much as you can. Read as much as you can, because that's when God's word cuts into our hearts. The second thing we see is they devoted themselves to grow in a family of faith. They didn't just devote themselves to the word by themselves. They did it together in a community. It says, and they devoted themselves to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread. This is community. This is one of the reasons why we're so big about small groups in this church. We don't want you to just have a relationship with God by yourself. It doesn't work that way, and it's not the biblical pattern. The biblical pattern is we do this together, and it's through relationships with one another, hearing one another's stories, being encouraged and challenged by one another. Like I said last week at Easter, I was so challenged by Sam and what God was doing in Sam's life. It really helped me as I was walking through a really tough time in my life. Man, I needed that, and I'm a pastor. We all need to be in relationships with one another. That's how God's word goes deep and begins to really change and minister to our hearts. If you're not in a small group, or if you don't go regularly, you need to get connected. Amen. Hebrews 10:24 says, and let us consider how we to stir one another to love and good works. Notice the stir one another, not God is going to stir you, right? It's we stir one another or provoke one another to love and good works. Not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another all the more as you see the day of judgment approaching, day drawing near. So it's meeting together regularly, being together in community. That's how God works in our heart. That's how the word that cuts us gets real, right? In our groups, we try to talk life and make it real, because that's where the real change and transformation happens. If you're not in a group, or if you don't go regularly, you can't, by the way, you can't say you're in a group if you go like once or twice a year, right? That doesn't count, right? So anyway, I just need to say that. And the last thing we see, and we're going to bring up our guest spot, is they devoted themselves to prayer, right? And they devoted themselves to prayer. Devote yourself to prayer, to the word, to doing life together in community, and to prayer. Truly, truly, Jesus says, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. Prayer is powerful. Prayer is powerful. Prayer is the conduit by which we see God reach into our situations, into our moments, and bring transformation. Prayer is also where God speaks to us and corrects some of the intentions of our heart. Prayer, by the way, can cut you too, because it's God's word that cuts us. Sometimes we think we're doing the right thing and we pray about it and God challenges our heart. We need to respond to the unction of the Holy Spirit because God is trying to adjust us. But if we're not in His word, we're not in community with others, we're not in prayer, we could be going off course and not even know it. And wonder why. Why do I keep experiencing the discipline of God rather than His favor? I hear about other people experiencing God's blessing. Why am I experiencing His discipline? Maybe it's because you're off track because you're not in His word, you're not in community, and you're not in prayer. Listen, the love of God is this. He's not mad at you. He loves you, but like a loving father, he wants to bring us back into walking in a right relationship with him. Because again, he'd rather bless us than discipline us. Amen? I'd rather bless my kids than discipline them. So if you're experiencing his discipline at this point, or you're not experiencing his favor, maybe it's one of these three, or maybe all. As we truly follow him, we will experience his favor. And God is so good that he leads us through situations and moments, rock bottom moments even, to get our attention so that we can come back to really walking in a relationship with him, that we'd really know him. And I wanted to, he shared his testimony at Easter at some of our services, but not at this one. And so I wanted to have him here because his story's so deep and we're gonna take a little bit further than we did last week. So will you help me welcome to the stage our guest spot to illustrate the message, Andrew Sato. Come on up, Andrew. Thanks, guys. Then we got some chairs, here we go. Some of you may have heard Andrew's testimony last week if you were at one of our Easter services that featured him. So if this is not your first time hearing this story, just laugh at the jokes and, you know, sound, you know, as impressed with the profundity. But if this is your first time, welcome. Andrew, graduate of Pearl City High School, come on, class of 98, yeah. All right, five of us. amazing educational institution. But Andrew grew up, you grew up religious. He's in my small group, by the way, so we kind of go way back, like a year. was religious. He admitted life was all about him, grew up kind of going to church, but it was kind of more about, God, how can you bless me? God, how can you make my life better? And was kind of more just a casual follower, right? Mm-hmm. And became a self-made man. You're successful. You owned a couple of businesses. You're an extra on Hawaii Five-0. I think we have a picture somewhere about that. He played a Yakuza member in Hawaii Five-0. Were those real guns, by the way?
Yeah, they were, but they weren't working. I think.
Sweet. All right. No, they weren't. And so he's been in TV commercials. Was even a finalist in American Idol. Tell us a little bit about that. What's the deal with that?
I entered a contest here locally. It's called Hawaii Idol with KHON, and I won. And they sent me up to the auditions in Seattle. So then I got past a few rounds. Didn't quite make it in front of Paula Simon Randy, but
stood in front of them.
Yeah, almost.
Oh, you almost made it. Oh, okay. I would love to hear what Simon would say to you. But anyway, you won brown bags at our school, though.
I did. I won brown bags class.
Come on, brown bags. Anybody remember brown bags?
Yeah. So I represented our school in 97.
Right there,
yeah.
Man. Yeah. Say, how many of you remember brown bags? You're like, what? All these high school kids are like, what the heck is that? Yeah. Is it a brown bag? What's the deal with that? Anyway, anyway, you know, of course, very talented musically, in business, entrepreneur. Even technically, which got you to computer hacking and got you into some trouble. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so kind of like what Billy was saying, you know, I was a casual Christian. You know, was always told you're supposed to go to church every Sunday. So I went to church every Sunday, sat, you know, in church, read the verses on the screen and sang. And, you know, prayed and tried to be a good person. So that's pretty much what I did as a casual Christian and doing what I was told. But then I ended up, you know, I pretty much tech savvy and kind of did a little bit of wire fraud and kind of got away with it. Again, did it for my own personal benefit, got a lot of stuff and, you know, and eventually I didn't think I was going to get caught, but I got caught. I got arrested and then I got sentenced to 18 months in federal prison.
Wow. And the journey to prison, you kind of thought that God would get you off of it. If you went to church and you did all the right things, you kind of thought that maybe God would help you to beat the rap.
Yeah, I did. So right when I got arrested, that was a big wake-up call. And I said, wow, okay, I'm sorry. I actually joined the worship team of the church I was casually going to, sang and did all this stuff, did community service and tried to be the best possible Christian I could possibly be. And I said, yeah, God, you know, I prayed to him and said, God, I know you're going to take care of me. I know you're going to get me off the hook. I know I'm not even going to go to prison. We're good. But then after that, it didn't work out that way. It didn't work out the way that I wanted it to work out or what I expected. I ended up getting sentenced for 18 months. And then actually my ex-girlfriend, who I was dating at the time, and I kind of pled guilty for, actually ended up breaking up with me. And then to make matters worse, she actually ended up dating the youth group pastor of the church that I was at. So I was like, wow, okay. So I was pretty mad at God, and I was like, man. But then I ended up going to prison, and then everything was taken away from me, and it was just that.
But that was the turning point, wasn't it? From going from being a casual attender, a casual Christian, now you find yourself in prison, really at a rock bottom moment, and that's where you finally maybe really look to God. Tell us about that.
It was. So, you know, spending one day in prison, 2 days in prison, it was just, it felt like the longest I've ever had to deal with. And then a week went by and I was like, wow, that felt like a year. And it was just like, I felt so hopeless and helpless, and just, you know, didn't have my friends and family near me, didn't know anybody. Everything was taken away from me, and everything that I needed, just clothes and everything else, was just in my locker. And so I decided, you know what, I'm gonna go down to the library and pick up a few books, and I'm just gonna read a whole bunch. So I picked up Harry Potter, Dan Brown, everything, and then I saw the Bible. So, you know, I was told to read the Bible, and I did, but I never really read it. And I was always told it's good to read the Bible at least once, you know, every year. So I decided, okay, I'm gonna grab the Bible and read it. And I was reading it, and it was then when I was broken and helpless that I was actually really developing a relationship with God. Again, it wasn't I was being told to, it was by choice that I actually really developed a relationship with God and really read the Bibles, read the scriptures, really let it speak to me. And it's funny because you read all these scriptures, you know, you memorize scriptures in Sunday school and all this other stuff, and it just means so much more when you're developing and you have a relationship with God.
You told us in group that it was almost the best thing for you because you spent that time in prison reading the Bible, going to church, and you really developed a real relationship with God that you didn't have before, even though it was just casual before.
It was. I still, to this day, I say that it was probably one of the best things to happen to me. It really helped me grow as a person. It helped me, again, allow me to develop and choose to develop a relationship with God. The other thing, too, is that I realized that, you know, life isn't just always about me. I started seeing opportunities of how I could help just being in there. I saw, you know, the church that was there didn't have any music, so I decided, you know what, I'm going to play the piano and sing and just help with that. But not only that, but I saw other inmates that were there that, you know, were a lot of them, most of them were high school dropouts. So there was a GED program, and GED testing that they could do, and a lot of them were trying to get their GEDs. So I created a little tutoring session where I could kind of give them some tips and tricks and how I actually was able to help them pass their GEDs. So just stuff like that, just notes that, just try to be as helpful as possible.
Because you came to really finally know him and walk with him, and God was changing you. Well, fast forward, you did your time, came out of prison, and God still was, there's still more shaping that he was doing in you, right?
Yeah,
there's a lot, right? So we'll just try to do this all in the time frame. But you got into business, had a really shady business partner, which made things really, really hard. You bought a house with your family. You got married with your wife, Ashley. Got into a house only to find out that your house had mold and all this damage, and you got displaced from your house, and now you're living in a one bedroom, right, with your wife and your kid, and that was hard, right? And then to take a break from all that, you take your family to Genki Sushi to enjoy some scallops. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I was a big, huge scallop fan. Not anymore. Like, ugh. But again, in October 2015, my family and I got displaced from our home. I owned an apartment. We were on the bottom level. But there was structural damage because of these trees that were growing outside of our unit, which caused water intrusion, which developed with mold, high levels of mold. So my family and I, my wife and my three-year-old son at the time, we couldn't live there anymore because it was just not safe for the whole family. We ended up moving out, had to pay out of pocket for living expenses and continue to pay the mortgage, but the association wasn't doing anything. Hired a lawyer wasn't doing anything. Again, I started feeling helpless, like, okay, this really sucks. I have no control over the situation that's happening. And again, my family's not in a home. Then on top of that, I ate Genki Sushi, and then ended up getting sick with Hep A. Seriously sick, ended up in ER twice, ended up being sick for 3 months. And like you said, you know, And at the time, my wife was pregnant with our second child, our daughter, and I was just stressing, like trying to put my family in a home. So I'm pushing, trying to get put in offers for a home. Got an offer that was accepted, and then I got hit with Hep A. So then I stopped working, and then the house fell through because I wasn't getting that income anymore. So again, even more helpless. So I was pretty in that situation where I'm like, geez.
What's going on? And that's when I got reconnected with Andrew. He joined our group before the Hep A thing. And, you know, he was walking through these challenges with his business, challenges with, you know, the house and just all of that that's going on. But one of the things that Andrew always said in our group was just how, you know, I'm trusting God. I know he's going to do something through this. I'm going to keep faithful and see what God does. And then he gets hit with Hep A. And I ain't going to lie to you. When you didn't come to group after that, I was like, man, me and the other guys were like, man, he cursed or something, like, what is going on? Because like one thing after another, now we didn't believe in that, but you know, one thing after another, so we just prayed for you. But here's the awesome thing, being an outside observer, is seeing how you stayed faithful to God during that process, and just saw as your devotion to him went like to another level. You know, you were devoted before, and it just kept on getting deeper and deeper and deeper level of devotion to God. And after the Hep A thing, it seems like things started to turn around in your life. You walk through that really, really dark time. I'll just outline it. After you went through Hep A, you were able to close that business with a shady business partner that wasn't going good. You got a settlement for your house and was able to fix and sell that house. And you got a new job offer that offered you a good salary. And then your daughter, Brooke, was born. I think we have some pictures. Can we throw up the pictures of the kids? There's the family, and there's the kids. There you go. The one. She's so pretty. She's just so cute. Your daughter was born. Yeah, there they are. And then so he starts telling us this stuff in group, just like these things are happening. And then you also met your birth father, whom you never knew.
It's pretty amazing.
Tell us a little bit about that. We've got a few minutes.
I've never known my father growing up. Had a stepfather, but was never close. Had a kind of rough relationship with that family growing up. But I guess my stepfather, I thought he had left me when I was a baby and had another family, so I never really wanted to look for him. But I guess he was looking for me my whole entire life. And we finally reconnected last Thanksgiving. We connected on Facebook. He was trying to find me and reached out to my wife and myself. We connected, surprised me with a visit on Thanksgiving, and I finally got to meet him after over 30 years. And it was amazing. Then I found out all this history about him, about that, you know, he wanted to take care of me, he wanted to be a father, and he was proud of me, but it, really amazing. And the nice thing about it, too, is that I found out I'm related to someone pretty big and famous, that his father, so my real grandfather, is Masahiko Kimura, which they named the Kimura Hold after in MMA and Jiu-Jitsu. He's the one who beat Helio Gracie 65 years ago.
We have some pictures of that, too. Go ahead and throw that up.
So he's the guy who beat Helio Gracie, the guy that started the Jiu-Jitsu movement, and they named that the Kimura Hold after him.
And so, I mean, you go now track this with me. He goes through this huge season of testing. It wasn't just a short one. And staying devoted, staying faithful, and now having come through that, God is beginning to bring things full circle in his life. You got the job, which enabled you to put down an offer on a house and get that offer accepted, and now you're about to move into a better house than the house that you couldn't get before because of all the things that you were going through. I mean, God was now taking all of this pain and bringing it full circle. Yeah, we think we have a picture of that new house. But one last thing before we tie this up in a nice little bow, you were tempted to go back, though. You were tempted to go back to your old ways of before Christ. The home loan wasn't going to go through because of certain things, and you were tempted to do something. Tell us about that and how God intervened.
Yeah, so this was actually pretty trippy. And so again, it was tough going through everything, and it was really tough. It seemed like everything was just coming down, but, you know, there was always, everything worked out. There was a bigger plan for everything. But yeah, what you're speaking of, this happened recently. Again, it put me in a situation where I kind of felt hopeless. So we were trying to buy the new house, and we were having some problems with the loan manager to get us approval for our home loan. The reason is because I opened up a Taco Del Mar location in Mililani Malka. We just closed, but then my business partner and I, we had an outstanding home loan. So long story short, we were having problems getting approved for the home loan, and got all the documentations I could possibly give to her, and eventually she just said, can you provide me with anything else showing that the business is closed? I felt hopeless again. I said, yeah, I gave you everything. I'm done. I don't know what else I can give to you. So then I said, okay, what about my CPA? I can have my CPA write a letter letting you know that we don't have any more losses. Had the CPA write a letter. She got it, and then she said, okay, the underwriter needs one certain sentence in there saying you're not going to have any more losses. And again, because we have our personal business loan, I asked the CPA if she could add that in. She said, no, I can't. So again, I started feeling helpless, and the loan manager was like, the underwriter said she'll sign off on the loan if she can just add this sentence in and you'll get the house. CPA, underwriter's not going to contact your CPA at all or question it, so that's all we need. So I wrote my CPA and I said, okay, can you just add this sentence in? I wrote out for her. And then I didn't get a response, and usually she's quick to responding. So I was just like, wow, okay, helpless again. Then I actually opened up the document and I photoshopped that sentence in.
Using your hacking skills.
Well, not hacking, but creative skills.
Criminal skills, yeah, go ahead.
Photoshopped it in, added all these little imperfections, like when you scan a document, and I stared at it and I was like, okay, I'm just gonna send this and we're gonna get the house.
So hold on, to be clear, you fraudulently produced the document.
I created.
To be clear, right? You were fraudulently produced the document.
Yeah. Yes, I did.
Okay. Continue, please.
This was last week, and so I'm looking
right
at
before it. Easter. By the way, sorry, I didn't need to say that.
Yeah. So we're still always dealing with challenges and
that's
trouble.
Right.
So I'm staring at it, and I'm just like, this is all we need. I'm thinking to myself, okay, I was told CPA is not going to contact them. I was told this is all we need. This is all we need. Then I stopped and I prayed. And I just cried, and I closed my office door so none of the salespeople would come in. I cried and I prayed and I said, God, I need this. We need this house. We've been out of home for so long. But like everything else, I'm going to trust you. If this house isn't the right house like the other house wasn't, I'm going to trust you. And please just continue to take care of my family. I know you have a plan for us. I deleted the document. And right after I was done praying, got an email from my CPA, and I opened it up, and it was she added that line in, and I was crying. I was so happy. Forwarded it right over to the loan manager right away. Loan manager was so happy. He said, "Yeah, you know what? That's it. So we're gonna. This is the date of signing. You should get your keys here. Whatever else." And I cried. Called my wife. Told her the whole story and told her we got it. And then I opened up the document out of my recycle bin. I put it side to side. I was like, wow, it looks almost exact, but.
You're good at what you do.
I was like, wow. But
the thing is, if you'd have sent that fraudulent document and then the CPA would have sent another one, there would have been two and you probably would have got caught.
Yeah, maybe. And then maybe if the CPA would have called to say thank you for the letter, and then maybe the house would have fallen through because we. And I might have gotten arrested or busted again.
Yeah, you might have gone back to jail.
Yeah.
But you see the picture, right? He trusted God, and God was developing a deeper level of devotion than tested. We're all going to be tested. There's nothing wrong with being tested. But it's when we're tested, are we going to go to God in prayer? Let His Word be the thing that guides us rather than our own abilities. And God shows that He's the one that's faithful. He's the one that did it. And you got that. You should have seen our group when he shared that in group. All the guys are like, you mean right after you closed the document and prayed, you got the email? He's like, yeah.
No joke. Like right after I said amen, it was like, refresh it. And it just popped up. I was like, whoa. And I opened it up. And I was like, God, thank God.
It's amazing, bro.
Thank God. And yeah, we got our keys on Friday. And we moved into our brand new 3-bedroom house, brand newly built in Coral Ridge. And, you know, praise God.
Amen. Come on. Give the Lord praise. Andrew, before it was all about you, and God took you through a process of learning devotion. It's not about you, it's about Him. And you really experienced His grace. He did this at all of our services last week, and I wanted Him to do it here. But could you just sing the first verse of Amazing Grace? Because we're going to close today by partaking of communion. And communion is remembering what Jesus did for us, which is the foundation of our trust in Him. And His grace is a powerful, is the most powerful tool in our lives that guides us and shapes us. Will you sing that line? Because you experienced it. God's grace your whole life, even in your own trials, and now seeing it come full circle. Could you just sing the first part of Amazing Grace for us as we segue into communion today?
Sure. Go ahead. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Thanks for joining us. Visit our website at pearlside.org for more.